Slip on your blue suede shoes, grease back that quiff, and do your best, as we welcome you to a time when Elvis shook up the world.
We all went.
We haven't seen anything like that before.
When Elvis came along, changed everything for me.
For young kids, he was our Jesus.
From the 50s screams to the 70s life of excess, Elvis was a big hunk of burning love.
He's a big flirt.
Oh, I would get so angry.
I lost my virginity to Elvis, which is a good place to go if you're going to lose your virginity.
Elvis had a way of dating a lot of women at the same time. He was extra special at it.
However you take your Elvis, slick back delinquent wrapped in black leather or rhinestone Goliath, he's the greatest selling, most influential single performer ever. Before him, there was Ovaltine and Family Favourites. After him, rock and roll began and popular music changed forever.
Elvis should have been president. Everyone knows that.
He was the coolest bloke who ever lived.
So it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Let's go, Cat, go. To find out why there's only one Elvis. Elvis died 25 years ago this week, but the king is always on our mind. 50,000 disciples are expected to make the pilgrimage to his Memphis home, Graceland, this weekend.
I am completely obsessed with Elvis. I can't remember when I didn't listen to Elvis records. I mean, obviously, I've got loads and loads of CDs. I've probably got about 50 different books. I've got a piece of wood from the fence at Graceland. I've got a hair from Elvis's horse. I bought a shirt which supposedly belonged to Elvis in auction. And I paid £11,200 for it. When I list them like this, it sounds like a form of mental illness.
Well, it's the one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready now.
Elvis gyrated out of Memphis and onto the world stage in 1956. He went on to sell more records than any other performer in history, with 18 number ones. Count 'em, that's 18, more than anyone else ever. Pick a chart, any chart, and he tops it.
Elvis had an animal quality, which I think men and women responded to. It's that unbelievable charisma and that incredible voice, and he was beautiful. I think he was probably the first beautiful rock star we had.
Elvis was entirely new and entirely different from anything that had gone before him. Well, you can do anything, but they hold for my
blue suede shoes. Did you vote for Elvis for president?
Pre-Elvis, pop belonged to crooners.
Before Elvis, there was only people like, Frank Sinatra. Strangers in the night. And your mother loved him.
And then there was Perry Como and his hot diggity dog, Diggity. It's a new to me. What you do to me?
Hot diggity dog, diggity from what you do to me. Everything was kind of squeaky clean and neat and well produced, and I'm for you and you're for me, icky dicky dicky dee. And suddenly it was like the bad guy had come into town.
And then you hear, well, since my baby left me, boom, boom, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, a heartbreak hotel. I'll make you so lonely, baby. Well, I'm so lonely. I'll be so lonely, I could die.
It's the first time I heard Elvis, and it changed everything for me. It's the one that inspired me and gave me my career. For broken-hearted lovers to cry there. It is a classic, classic, and nothing's ever been made like it.
It was staggering, you know what I mean? It was like intravenous excitement, and it was ours.
We
know, less than 2 years ago, you were earning $14 a week as a movie usher. And today, you're the most controversial name in show business. Has this sudden notoriety affected your sleep, your appetite, or the size of your head?
Not the size of my head. It's affected my sleep.
How much sleep do you get?
Well, I average about 4 or 5 hours a night, I guess.
Is that enough?
Well, it's really not, but I'm used to it, and I can't sleep any longer.
Ready, set, go, man, go. I got a gal that I love so.
I met Elvis is 54. Before he even had a record, he had those star qualities. As a young kid, I went, wow, I'd like to be like him.
I think it's extraordinary. I mean, he really was naturally great. Rock and roll. This effortless flow, you know, and how can he dance like that? And he was a fantastic dancer. And the joy of it, he's smiling all the time. It isn't a surly, sultry thing. He's laughing and enjoying it, you know. I just think when you watch that 18-year-old boy, what could stop that? What could stop it? Nothing's going to stop that.
Elvis, nothing was contrived. People thought, oh, he's posing, he's gesturing, you know, he's doing that little curled lip on purpose. And it's just who he was.
Ready to rock and roll. Thank you very much.
Elvis grew up in the deep south of Mississippi and Tennessee. The Presleys were a poor family struggling to make ends meet in the post-Depression 30s.
Elvis grew up in a largely black neighborhood. I think his music demonstrated a major black influence because it was an amalgamation of gospel, rockabilly, rhythm and blues. All right.
At one of Elvis's first recording sessions for Sun Records, he sang a little-known rhythm and blues track.
When we were about ready to go home, Elvis started to sing That's All Right, Mama. And when I heard that, I could not have controlled my inner response. If I'd have wanted to, I heard one of the most beautiful, untrained voices.
Elvis had originally heard That's All Right performed by blues singer Big Boy Crudup. But because mainstream radio at the time only played white artists, it hadn't been a hit.
They didn't want to hear from black people at that time. We had segregated audiences, and it was a task getting our pictures on album covers. They didn't want to see black performers.
We, the white society, had no contact with the black society, unless it was in a subservient role. And Elvis's music was putting it on an equal basis. You know the landlord rang my front
door bell. Elvis was looked upon, particularly down here in the Bible Belt, as the devil reincarnated. And there were sermons in the pulpit.
We've set up a 20-man committee to do away with this vulgar, animalistic, nigger rock and roll bar.
The obscenity and vulgarity of the rock and roll music is obviously a means by which the white man and his children can be driven to the level with a nigger. It is obviously nigger music. I said, tell me, baby, face to face, well, how could
another man take my place? The establishment reaction was complete horror because he was such a rupture with the past. This was horrifying to him, because he didn't really want to offend anyone. He was a polite Southern boy, and he didn't get it.
Do you think that your rocking and rolling has had an evil influence on teenagers?
In a lot of the papers, they say rock and roll is a big influence on juvenile delinquency. I don't think that it is.
And do you think you've learned anything from the criticism leveled at you?
No, I haven't.
You haven't, huh?
Because I don't feel that I'm doing anything wrong.
Elvis really did have a difficult time. He bordered on probably being the most timid person. And I would say the most shy person I've ever known. He worked his butt off, but he never got over that shyness.
Everything has happened to me so fast in the last year and a half till I'm all mixed up, you know? I mean, I can't keep up with everything that's happening.
In just 18 months, Elvis had gone from Memphis truck driver to superstar and millionaire. In 56, his string of hits topped the charts for 6 months, and Elvis became the hottest draw on national television.
I want to tell you something. Incidentally, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think that I'm revealing any secrets when I say that Elvis Presley is the fastest rising young singer in the entertainment industry today.
I think a lot of the actual rawness and that teenage rebellion was in the vocal. It still makes the hairs go on the back of my neck. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. The voice has got that kind of growl to it, and everything seems to have a kind of menace or some sort of suggestiveness about it.
He didn't need a drummer. His voice was a tempo. You know, he sang, you know, with a feeling. So didn't need me, really. We did the Milton Berle show. And all of a sudden, he decides he's going to go into this blues thing. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. That was the first time he had done it anywhere. So what are we going to do? We'll follow him. That's all we could do. We didn't know how to get out or how to get back in. We were just, it's like every man for himself, actually. You ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound. We got through it, and we said, well, why'd you do that? He said, you got it. You guys caught it. It was okay. Never got lost. You couldn't lose him, you know, musically. He had an ear that just was uncanny. You ain't another corner rabbit. You ain't no friend of
mine. When Elvis came to town, the town went crazy.
Boy, you know, his communication was great. I don't know what he did. He'd have them all on his side. They're eating out of his hand. He had that little go-to-heck smile, you know, that people liked. And he just got away with it.
On the road with Elvis in the early days was complete bedlam. They would scream from the moment he walked out to the moment he walked off the stage. You could almost barely hear what he was saying and singing. They would rush the stage. That was the scary part.
We was in Kansas City, up about 3 or 4 foot high. And we said, well, we're safe up here, you don't know. I can't get up here. And next thing you know, there was 10,000 of them up there. We all looked around, and I said, where's Elvis? Elvis was on his knees, and he crawled out from that crowd. I never seen a guy move so fast. I looked around, and I saw my bass drum. Guy had it over his head, like this, going out with it. I guess he's gonna take it home with him.
The thing that was driving Elvis fans crazy, particularly little girls, was one, his looks, and two, the gyrations.
You kind of expect that when you think back on all the fuss about Elvis's moving on stage, that when you watch it now, it'll be incredibly tame. But I don't think it is that tame. Just a bigger, bigger,
bigger hunger love. You could see that he was kind of turning himself on. Which is always a turn on.
It was almost like he freed something inside himself, some sort of like weird inner demon that we all keep screwed up and tightly screwed down inside. And ew, it's out. Hey, what are you doing? Stop it. Don't let the children watch.
Elvis's gyrations were so disturbing that when he appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show, they censored his performance.
They filmed him from the waist up because they thought that was cleaner. I've seen that many, many times, and to me, it's just like the way women are sexier in bikinis than naked. You just think, God, what's going on? You start looking under the television set to see what's moving. You know I can be found sitting home all alone. If you can't come around, at least please a telephone.
that just shot it through the ceiling, because that helped it, because that created more interest. Well, why are they shooting him from the waist up? What's the deal on this guy? Everybody was looking and wanted to know what was going on with this Elvis Presley guy.
I think that was a hype in the first place. I think Sullivan probably blowed smoke on people and made them believe that's he was vulgar and this stuff. And I think it was one of the set. I think it was a setup.
An amazing 80% of the American television audience watched this performance, but that little box couldn't hold him for long. Elvis had his eye on bigger things and was bound for Hollywood.
Now he's gone from this 14-inch television set to CinemaScope. Just to see him up there in all his glory, it was just the most marvelous thing.
How dare you think such cheap tactics would work with me?
Tactics, honey. Just the beast in me.
They were so big films, they used to queue up. And those were the days when you went to the cinema and you screamed in the cinema. I know, how sad is that? Well, that's all we had. Everybody let it rock.
Everybody knows ever. And I remember sitting in the back of the Granada Cinema in Mansfield, film opening, and the girls went berserk. Never heard anything like it before, and I think two or three days I just sat and watched it all day. Well, by the end of the week, I think I'd seen the film about 24 times.
How's your headache?
I'm getting all unglued.
I think Elvis is the best looking male human being I've ever seen.
I love you, baby. I guess it's just because you're so square. Baby, I don't care.
He looked great. You see, I mean, the whole thing is you wanted to look like him. You didn't just want to sound like him. You wanted to look like him. You wanted your hair to go like his. Ask you love me like you do. In school days, two of us, we had the best quiffs. He was blonde and I was dark. We had the best Elvis-type haircuts. And we were the hits with the girls. Because you're so square.
Baby, I don't care. If you're talking about the top 10 of quiffs, Elvis is the quiff for me. Baby,
I don't care. I tried to look like Elvis when I used to comb my hair back even as a kid, and I used to wear my collar turned up like this, you know. So I'd be going to school like this, age about 7. And I thought if only my hair was black, I'd look exactly like Elvis. In fact, I look much more like Stan Laurel. Then I found out that Elvis actually dyed his hair black, and his hair was pretty well the same colour as mine. So, all those years of envy, thus proving that the other man's hair is always blacker.
You got the feeling that Elvis walked that walk all the time. He looked that way all the time. And just seeing the way he did things with clothes, I mean, he had a great frame for clothes. And you see him in those early rock and roll one-button draped jackets. Perfect. No one can beat that look.
When I went to his room, he had this huge double closet. I never saw him wear the same thing twice. When you kiss me. Back then, he was kind of a loud dresser. You know, he liked to wear colorful things. But you know what? He wore what he liked. He didn't care if you liked it or if you didn't like it.
He was a real individual. I want to wear a pink shirt, I can wear a pink shirt now. I couldn't. I would have gotten beat up in Memphis if I did that before Elvis started doing it. Well, I went to the bayou just
last night. There was no moon, but the stars were bright. He was the most gorgeous man, I think, that God ever created. His skin was perfect, his nose was perfect. He was like a Greek god. I remember lying awake at night sometimes and just staring at his face.
Crawfish,
Hi.
Oh, hello.
I don't give me that. I saw you looking. See, I
got him. He was the best looking man that I've ever met before or since. He just perfect specimen. He gets a top 10.
Fresh and ready to cook. Elvis and Anita began dating in 57 and were together for 5 years.
On the first date, we just went driving around Memphis, talking and meeting each other, getting to know one another. And then he took me to Graceland and proceeded to show me around his home because he had just purchased it. It was very pretty and palatial. The colors were just a little bit gaudy, a little bit, but this was his taste.
When I went to Graceland, people say to me, oh, you won't like Graceland, it's terrible bad taste, you know. And I thought, no, this isn't bad taste, it's great. This is what a bloke's house should look like. There's a real sense of no female influence at all in any of the decoration, furniture, anything. It's one bloke thinking, well, I've got a lot of money, why not buy this? There's a room called the Jungle Room, which is like this furniture that looks like it was perhaps used in King Kong. It's like tree trunks shaven off and turned into little chairs and stuff like that. It's fantastic.
When not being king of his jungle room, Elvis loved to go to the fun fair, taking his date and all of his mates.
Elvis liked people being around him. I learned through the years that you are very seldom alone with Elvis. You know, the guys are there. That's part of his life.
Elvis surrounded himself with a blokey entourage of family, friends and employees, later on to become known as the Memphis Mafia.
He didn't trust people. He thought some people might like him because of who he was. So these guys that he had around him, he trusted them. And he liked company. Such a kiss.
And when it came to getting Elvis's attention, it wasn't just the guys Anita was competing with.
There were lots of girls, all sizes, all shapes, all ages. It was a big flirt. Oh, I would get so angry. But he kept assuring me, and I was the one that he wanted to be with. He could always convince you there was nothing going on with anybody else, you know.
But Uncle Sam was about to poop the party.
Elvis Presley no longer has that rock and roll beat. The tempo is hut, two, three, four for Private Presley.
When Elvis got drafted, it was a very dark moment. Now, Elvis put up a good front, but he wasn't really happy about going in the Army. I don't think anybody would at that time. In 1958, there was no war going on.
I Elvis Presley.
And here's a guy who's the number one superstar in the world at that time, making zillions of dollars, and all of a sudden, it all comes to a halt.
The call-up particularly upset Elvis's mother, Gladys.
I remember the day when he got the notice. His mother just went into deep depression. She could not stand to think of him going into the Army, not only away from her, but in harm's way. And she was just devastated.
Elvis and his mother were extremely close. Elvis was an only child. His twin brother had died at birth.
We'd go by there and pick him up. We hadn't been out of Memphis 10 minutes. He said, I got to call my mama. And he'd call his mother, I bet you, four or five times in a matter of just a few hours.
I remember we took him to the bus station, and his mother was just so sad. It was just heartbreaking. And I was sad too, and I was the last person that he hugged and kissed. And he said, don't forget me, little. That was it. He got on the bus.
5 months into his 2-year Army service, his mother became seriously ill and died.
When she died, I think he died then. That was traumatic for him.
Pulling up to Graceland, there was Elvis and his dad sitting on the steps, and they looked so forlorn, so sad. I guess the saddest I've ever seen Elvis. He took me into where she was in his coffin, and they had a glass over her because they said that was to keep him from touching her so much. You heard me. I mean, it's even hard to think about it still. It was so sad. And he was never the same after that. Oh, he laughed and he enjoyed life, but he was still, there was something about him that was quite different. A sadness that was always there.
I honestly think if his mother had lived, there was a good possibility Elvis Presley would still be alive today.
After brief compassionate leave, Elvis had to return to the army and was assigned to Germany.
Elvis, what do you think about going to Germany?
Well, sir, I'm kind of looking forward to it.
Is your hair growing back in, Elvis?
It's growing out a little, but I won't be able to let it get as long as it was till I get out.
Can we take a look at it now?
Since you've been in the Army, what kind of a cloistered life? Are you? Is it a relief to get away from all the autograph hounds and the hysterical females?
It is not. If nobody comes up and asks for an autograph or if no one bothers you, well, then you start worrying.
Elvis, what's your idea of the ideal girl?
Female, sir.
I remember Elvis being in Germany, which I thought was great because that's Europe, that is so much near me.
Mr. Presley, and we wish you a pleasant stay in Germany.
Thank you very much. Arrivederci. Well, that's Italian.
Then the biggest thrill for me was Priscilla came along, but I thought, my name's Priscilla.
This Priscilla was the daughter of an American Air Force officer.
Get horse and feather and black pumpernickel for chow.
I was there the day he met Priscilla. She was very shy and naturally overwhelmed. Elvis sat down, played some songs. They got to relax her a little bit.
I just remember thinking, what am I going to say? You know, it was like a dream. What does one say to Elvis Presley or to a famous movie star?
Tell us, how are you going to break the ice with this gal? What's your angle?
Charm, boy. Charm.
He came over to me and asked me what I did, how old I was, which I was hesitant in answering because I didn't want to tell him I was only 14 years old. I just turned 14 years old. I looked a little older anyway at that time.
I knew she was very young, but I did not expect that she was 14 at the time. She didn't seem 14, but maybe 16.
He was very lonely over there, and he wanted to talk to someone, and for some reason he really trusted me, and he poured his heart out. I think the motherly instinct came out in me, because I think he brought that out in every woman.
Occupation G.I. Blue. Occupation G.I.
Blue. Ready. The heady cocktail of young love, Bavarian mountain air and men in leather shorts so bamboozled Elvis that he decided to record a German folk song.
Sei mir gut, sei mir gut, sei mir gut, sei mir gut, cause I'm not made of wood and I don't have a...
What?
Weirdly, I have a thing about wooden heart. When he starts singing in German, that's strangely pleasing.
Gosh, I love that record. And sang in German.
That crap faux German thing. I mean, what's that? I mean, you know, it was so grotesque.
No pleasing some. Still, Elvis and his Moosey Den were at number one for 6 weeks. After 18 months of sauerkraut and square bashing, Elvis was demobbed in 1960. Priscilla was there to see him off at the airport.
I just remember feeling very numb. He told me, he said, look, you know, I'm going to look for you in the crowd. And I said, you'll never see me, there's so many people. But I do remember he got on the top of the stairs and he waved. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I held a lot of my emotions back because he kept assuring me that I would see him and that would one day go to Graceland.
Elvis had been away from the public and performing for 2 years, and he was unsure what kind of reception he'd get.
Elvis Presley is home. A cameraman asked him to wave at a girl, and he said it's not very hard to do.
He needn't have worried. The ladies still loved him. One brazen strumpet even slipped her phone number into his jacket. Top marks.
One young lady said this morning in the interview that you were the sexiest man she'd ever seen. What's your reaction to that? Are we on television?
Have 2 years of sobering army life changed your mind about rock and roll?
No, it hasn't. It hasn't changed my mind, because I was in tanks for a long time, you see. And they rock and roll quite a bit.
He's fabulous!
Fabulous?
Fabulous! He's a king!
When he came back, it was just like the king was home again. I mean, it was kind of crazy. It was as though he hadn't been gone anywhere. And then, boom, he's right on the TV with Frank Sinatra.
Professionally, all was well. Stuck on You, the song Elvis would sing on the show, sold 1.5 million copies within 72 hours. But offstage, his personal life was getting crowded.
When he got home, he kept saying, you know, I can't wait to see Priscilla again. And as you know, he was dating Anita before he went in the Army, and he was dating Anita when he got out of the Army. So it was a strange situation for him at that time. Stick like glue. Stick
because any romance, did you leave any heart?
There was a little girl that I was seeing quite often over there that her father was in the Air Force. And
I had seen a little bit in the papers, like everybody else had. He'd assured me, nobody, nothing.
The stories came out, the girl he left behind, and all that. It wasn't like that. I mean, I had to be careful when I answer a question like that.
So this day, I was looking for a book. There was a book on the desk. And sticking out the top of the book was a letter from Priscilla. You know what I did? I read it. Yes, sir. And the letter said, please, I want to come over so bad. If you will call my daddy and talk to him, I know he will let me come. My word, how much she loved him and cared for him and all this. Man.
Believe me, you could not say no to Elvis. I don't care who it was. He had a boyish charm and trusting. You trusted him.
I don't know what he was telling her. You know, I know he's telling me, because he was trying to juggle the both of us. He said, well, I'm going to make that decision for you. It's not going to be hard for you to make, because I'm going to leave. It was very sad. It was the most difficult decision I ever made.
Soon after, Priscilla arrived from Germany and moved into Graceland. She was just 17.
Elvis wanted her to come over at a very young age because he wanted to make this woman the way he wanted her to be. He wanted to groom her for his wife or future wife to be.
5 years later, Elvis made an honest woman of her in Vegas.
Elvis Presley weds Priscilla Ann Vogel, and one of America's richest teenage singing idols promises to love, honor, and obey. Why did the pelvis desert bachelorhood? Said he, it's about time.
When he first got married, he really was a good boy for a while. He was not the wild Elvis that we used to know. But little by little, he got back to that.
For years, Elvis had rocked his hulas with a host of starlets in a series of 60s Hollywood movies. And when she starts to sway, I've
got to say, she really moves the grass around. Movie years were fun. A lot of fun on the movie sets. And yes, he had a great time with a lot of his co-stars.
Would you like to make love to me?
We always used to hate the lead. You know, there was always the romance involved in the film, and that was the only time when we used to sneer and think.
Do you think you can satisfy a school teacher and four teenage girls?
Oh, I'll sure try, now. I like to live dangerously.
I can't even remember one lady who played opposite Elvis because we didn't want to know. It's blotted, totally blotted from my memory.
For others, though, the memories are as fresh as ever.
Can you help me, please?
Can we help you? Yes, ma'am.
Well, then I'd like you to check my motor. It whistles.
I don't blame it.
What did you say?
Oh, forgive me. My memories was what great legs Anne Margaret had, and what a classy-looking girl she was, and what a lucky bugger he was. Because I think there was a little bit more to that than met the eye. I think she might have been all shook up, I don't know. But I would presume that, otherwise he's not the man that I sincerely believe he was.
I'll be happy to drive you wherever you want to go.
And why should you go to all that bother?
Because around here I'm known as your very bothering mechanic.
I think most of the leading ladies got done by Elvis.
I'm sure you are.
And so it should be. Truly all is well with the world.
Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul on fire.
And you know, what would the kids look like, Elvis and Anne Margaret?
Anne Margaret, yes, that was a special situation. They were inseparable for a long time.
They're all living the devil may care, and I am just a devil with no despair. So viva Las Vegas.
I was asked to be in a movie with him. My husband turned it down for me. I wonder why.
24 hours in the day.
Elvis's 60s movies were, well, predictable. Glamorous locations, the occasional embarrassing native costume, and the odd high-speed crash.
They're like porn movies, insofar as the plot and all the other characters exist only to get you to the next song, and the song being the sexual act in this case.
Guess what, Kevin? What? We made it.
We made it?
Didn't we?
Well, I've got a gal, she's as cute as she can be. She's a distant cousin, but she's not too distant with me.
It's not important. You can't remember names, you can't remember details. No one comes away from kissing cousins thinking, wow, thank God that turned out okay.
Kissing cousin, that's what makes it all right, all right, all right, all right.
What are you doing with my face?
That's all right, good question, friend.
What's your name? Josh Morgan, from Hidden Rock, North Carolina.
Then you're kinfolk.
Practically kissing cousin.
You know, it's ludicrous. It's nonsense. It's Elvis in a blonde wig, for God's sake. No one could not have noticed that.
Okay, no Citizen Kane, but these sing-along corn-tastic movies were massive box office successes with chart-topping soundtracks, and Elvis became the best-paid actor in Hollywood, earning $1 million a picture. But by the end of the 60s, Elvis had churned out 31 of the blighters, and they were running out of legs.
Although I have an affection for those crappy 60s films, he made far too many of them. And because they needed to sell a soundtrack album off the back of them, they packed them with songs instead of doing anything with a kind of storyline or dialogue. Should I
cry? After a while, it became like a travelogue, in the same movie, a different location, different song.
All right, you guys, let's go.
So Elvis was realizing that, you know, there were no good roles for him. There was nothing Hollywood will put you down, grind you into the ground, the same stuff.
Elvis's Hollywood contracts had been negotiated by longtime manager, the self-styled Colonel Tom Parker, who went for the bucks and plenty of them.
Colonel Parker was brilliant, great deal maker, but he couldn't hear a hit song. He didn't know if a script was good or bad or not, but it was hard to talk to Colonel Parker because he would tell you, he said, there's a guy's walking Hollywood Boulevard with Oscars in their hand that can't get arrested. My boy's getting $1 million up front at 50% of the picture. That's all Hollywood understands. We're going to ride this horse until we can't ride it anymore.
Colonel Parker made a lot of money off Elvis. No two ways about it. At first, he was getting 20 or 25% when he first started managing. But after a while, he started getting 50% of the merchandising deals, of the tours, and those kinds of things.
Getting 50% was unheard of.
In those days, I think management looked at their artists as products to get what they can out of what they can. Who knows what might have happened if Elvis hadn't gone into those comic movies? He could have become a great actor.
By the end of the swinging 60s, Elvis was at the low point of his career. The public were becoming tired of the cheesy movies, he was having little chart success, and had not performed live on stage for 8 years.
He had missed being on the charts. He needed to be contemporary again. He didn't know if he could.
Elvis decided to relaunch his career on television with the NBC 68 Comeback Special, his first small screen appearance since the Sinatra show in 1960.
I read in the paper that was going to be this Elvis special. I just couldn't believe it. And I kind of got positioned on the settee at home about 4 hours before it came on. And it was just... I can still remember it opening with... Elvis going, looking for trouble?
You're looking for trouble? You came to the right place. You're looking for trouble? Just look right in my face. I was born standing up and talking back. My daddy was a green.
No videos or anything then, so you didn't get the, oh, well, I'll tape that and keep it forever. You just sat and thought, I have to watch this kind of like this, because I have to remember every second of this thing.
So don't you mess around with me.
The show contained a now legendary informal jamming session with Elvis and his original 50s band.
We went out to do the 68 special. Elvis, boys, you know, we got to... to do this sit-down set, you know, in the middle, you know, in the round. Elvis said, I don't know, I'm a little scared of this.
At the time we were ready to do the first show, all of a sudden I got word while I was on stage that Elvis urgently needed to see me. And he said, I can't do it. And I said, Elvis, this is not the time to tell me you can't do it. You've got to do it.
Boy, my boy. A long time, Jack, I'm telling you.
He walked out there, and the only reason we stopped it is because we were running out of tape. I mean, he never looked back.
And it was like jamming. It was brilliant. He just sang. You suddenly realized there were no effects on his voice. There was nothing clever. He did Unplugged 20 years before it ever happened. He was dynamite.
He came back to the animal magnetism that he always had. When you saw Elvis sit with his friends and just play and strum and sing, there's something magic about that.
I think the 68 Comeback Special still stands up today.
I'm all shook up.
The black leather outfit was inspired. No one before or since has worn black leather as well as that, and believe me, I've tried. And I've scoured the internet for pictures, but there's no one out there who looks as good in black leather as Elvis did at that precise moment in history.
Elvis started to really sweat, and his hair started getting mussed up. NBC were very unhappy with seeing Elvis Presley in prime time at 8 o'clock with sweat on his forehead.
Baby, what do you want me to do?
That's the gold. I mean, that's what the audiences are going to go nuts over.
to see him like that was a revelation, I think. And you get a real feel for him, to show he could still do it, and do it better than anyone else.
The 68 special was a triumph, and it topped the ratings.
When the programme finished, I sat there and I was just numb. I thought, he's starting again.
Rejuvenated by the success of the TV show, Elvis returned to the stage, breaking all records in Vegas.
Very lucky, I was in Las Vegas and there were queues round the block to get in to see him.
Hope you enjoy our show.
Every performance was standing room only, so we couldn't get in. Isn't that remarkable?
Hope I don't forget the words to
I know that he was concerned about how's this going to go. I hope they like me.
I just can't help believing she's lying just beside me. And my heart beats with the rhythm.
The only one right there, that first word. You got the rest of it.
I'll get through the first one, I get it.
Right. Opening night, I tell you, Elvis was, I mean, he made us nervous being so nervous.
Again.
Huh? Well, it starts to get tense about this time.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, the lights went down, and they played the Space Odyssey 2001, and you got a shiver.
When you hear bum 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 da 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 da, boom! I'm gone every time.
He walked out on that stage. I'll never forget that.
Well, I said I got a woman
way across town. She's good to me. Oh, yeah.
But when that audience did what they did, he knew who he was and where he was and what he could do.
I see my baby, don't you understand?
He went crazy, the crowd went crazy, and he was in
heaven. They loved him. That's the difference. Certain performers are admired. With Elvis, there was a wave of love hit him.
I went along to see him in the Hilton. I think it was the first time he had performed Suspicious Minds. And it was extraordinary.
We're caught in a trap. I can't walk out. Because I love you too much, baby.
There are millions who argue it was one of the great voices of the century, without question. Without question. Identifiable and will be identifiable.
Every word I'm saying. We can't go on together.
His voice was very rich, had matured. He had an enormous range, and the rich quality of it was just very shocking to me.
Won't let our love survive. Oh no, I'll dry the tears from your eyes.
Ordinarily, only a trained singer, someone who really studies voice, would be able to even hit the notes that he was able to hit.
Lie to you.
And he just didn't think about it. He just did what he felt like doing, and his voice responded. Yeah. It was just there.
We're caught in a trap.
In the early years in Vegas, it was great, brilliant shows, and Elvis just rocked. And it's really unfortunate that when people think of that Vegas Elvis, they think of this fat guy. Because that really was just the end. It's just wrong.
Because I love you too much.
When he was on top form, he was unbeatable.
Because I love you too much, baby.
In love again with live performance, Elvis went back on the road touring the States, performing 150 shows a year. every show was a sellout.
Song's on over, we can do a medley of
we can pray.
Elvis's shows were designed to thrill, and he developed a unique, dazzling wardrobe of rhinestone jumpsuits, belts, and capes.
Elvis thought, hey, I'm in show business. You know, I don't want to walk out there in a t-shirt and a pair of jeans. So I'm here to entertain people.
I can appreciate there's much fun to be had with the Elvis suit. And I tell you, there's something strangely liberating about slipping into an all-in-one, cut down to your waist, covered in gold butterflies. When you put the cape on, you feel good.
As if the rhinestone cat suits weren't enough, Elvis threw in karate.
We got to match it up, baby, before we fall apart at the seams.
He'd actually been into martial arts for 15 years and was an 8th Dan black belt.
No, that's karate.
Or was he?
It's one of the great mysteries of the Elvis world, whether Elvis was really a karate expert or whether people were so happy that he'd come to their karate school, they just gave him a black belt the way you might give someone a souvenir bookmark. There's some fantastic photos of Elvis doing karate with his shades on. Which is, to me, there you have Elvis, summed up.
Elvis was Elvis, you know, 24-7. Even when he put his pajamas on, he took like a certain little flair and pulling up the collar. And he knew that his audience and his public expected a certain kind of image, and he didn't want to disappoint anybody if they happened to catch a glimpse of him out. So he wanted to be Elvis. He had an effect on people like no other.
I can't believe I thought I've loved him for 9 years.
Be like a fool, treat me mean and cruel.
Elvis was a very sexy individual. Just loved to be around women, loved their attention, and loved their company.
Yes.
I met him backstage, and he was absolutely charming. I mean, he was dynamite, and he was certainly flirting with me. He was dishy, and he knew it.
How many girlfriends? Never more than, say, two or maybe three at one time. And when you're in a position like he was, where there's many good-looking women coming at you from many directions, the temptation is there, and he gave into it.
Oh, Vegas years. I could not tell you how many. My mind is blank. It was just one big blur.
Elvis had lots and lots and lots and lots of women, and I don't think that stopped while he was married.
Are these yours, honey?
But God, if you were Elvis, it's almost an act of charity to have sex with someone if you look like Elvis.
I'm on the roll all over you.
Because that's something they're going to have for the rest of their lives. That is the gift that keeps on giving. They've been touched by greatness.
Stand back, girl.
Certainly, if I'd have been married at the time, I would have said to my wife, look, it's Elvis, you get a special dispensation. You can go as long as you tell me exactly what it was like.
I'm a semen mixer.
Elvis was my first true love, and he was my first lover. I lost my virginity to Elvis, which is a good place to go if you can lose your virginity. I think Elvis appreciated the fact that I was a virgin, and I think he definitely enjoyed being able to take a young girl and say, I just kind of want her to be what I want her to be. And he had major influence on me.
Elvis was my first real love, yes. I was waiting for marriage and had not had an intimate relationship with a man at that point. And that was the beginning of a relationship that a friendship that I that lasted 7 years, you know.
Is the wife Priscilla with you?
No, she's not.
I mean, he really had his cake and he was eating it too. He'd spent a lot of time away. Now, he was in Vegas. He lived at the hotel there. He had his freedom. The only thing that really kept us together, of course, was the baby, and I was struggling.
Elvis and Priscilla's daughter, Lisa Marie, was 4 years old when Priscilla left Elvis for a karate instructor.
You can't blame any of the women we were with at that time. My wife left me, too. I was surprised they lasted as long as they did. I mean, because we were not married. The wives were married. We weren't married.
It had to have hurt his ego, and because here's a man who's adored by the world, and the lady he marries is leading him for somebody else.
I just never took the time.
I remember Elvis talking to me about it, and he said, "This guy's a karate teacher, for God's sake. You know, he makes $25,000 a year. I'm Elvis Presley. She left me for him." You know, you can't really blame her for finding another man. She was a little woman who was at home with the baby. He didn't take her with him when he toured. He didn't take her with him to Vegas, except for opening night, and then all the wives had to go home, and the girlfriends came in.
Former Miss Tennessee Linda started dating Elvis soon after his split from Priscilla.
The first year that we were together, I know beyond any shadow of a doubt that Elvis was faithful to me because we were together 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. However, after that first year, I could sense a restlessness and I knew that he was unfaithful to me. You know, I wasn't stupid. He would say, "Honey, you know, you might hear rumors that I was with someone else this weekend, but I mean, if you happen to believe that, I just want you to know that nobody could ever compare to you and that you're the one I love and nobody else holds a candle to you." And he would always make me feel like I was the most cherished, loved woman on earth, even though he had other liaisons with other women.
When it came to spending his money, Elvis spent like there was no tomorrow. In 1 year, he bought 2 planes, dozens of cars, and thought nothing of blowing $30,000 a time at the jeweler's. And he spread it around.
Generous. Elvis Presley invented the word.
The first gift he gave me was a real pretty sapphire and diamond ring.
He gave me 2 Cadillacs.
My home on the West Coast.
It was this 1971 280 SL Mercedes Benz.
They gave me cars.
7 cars.
5 watches.
Poodle dogs.
Jewelry.
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 Always buying me jewelry.
He didn't get generous till after I left.
In one little bout of retail therapy, Elvis bought and gave away 13 Cadillacs, including one for a lady who just happened to be passing by.
Well, his dad said to him one time, his son said, "You've got to be careful." He said, "You've given away over $90,000 this week." Never saw Daddy. Said, "I can make that much money tomorrow." He got as much joy out of giving you a brand new car as you did in getting it.
I very much respect Elvis's excess, lunatic generosity. I mean, I love that story when Elvis sent the boys into town to buy every light bulb they could possibly find. Then he put them all in the swimming pool. And then he sat with a pellet rifle and shot the bulb. And of course they explode and sink. And he spent about 2 or 3 days doing it. It must have been so satisfying. And then he had to get someone in and pay him, I don't know how many $1,000s to clean the pool. Who cares? There's a little bit of Elvis in all of us. It's that part of you that just lets go.
As well as spending millions on fast cars and jewelry, Elvis liked to collect guns.
Oh, guns.
Elvis started going gun shopping. Well, when he got guns, everybody got guns. And I still have the gun that he gave me.
Guns were not a big thing to us. I kind of miss carrying my gun and stuff. I didn't like it then. Now I kind of miss it.
Elvis had received several death threats, and he became convinced there might be an assassination attempt.
What are you looking at back there?
He said, I'm not going to let some guy blow my brains out on stage or anywhere. I'm going to carry a gun.
All her brothers were fit for stealing watermelons out of my truck. Patch folks out of here.
When he was on stage in Vegas, he used to have a gun tucked down his boot. And the image of Elvis on the stage with blood all over his jumpsuit, firing wildly into the crowd to try and hit this assassin, you know. Women and children dropping like flies all around him. And the band still playing Polk Salad Annie.
Elvis was kind of crazy. You know, he had a propensity for just whipping out the pistol. If someone were on TV that he didn't like, he shot it. One night, the car wouldn't start. And he said, honey, get out of the car. I said, no. He says, get out of the car, please. Just step away from the vehicle. So I got out of the car dutifully, stepped away, and he put 5 shots into this car. We got back in the car. He says, let's just see what happens, and started right up.
Shooting at stuff was just one bad habit of Elvis and his Memphis Mafia's passion for excess.
We played hard, and we did play hard. While we were in Vegas, we were staying up all night partying, and we had to take a lot of things to keep awake.
Straight vodka, man. About 3 minutes before you go.
And his mama cried.
And it became a routine. If you felt a little tired, here, take one of these little pills, and you pop a pill, and it kept you awake.
Elvis and his buddies had first started to take amphetamine pills whilst they were in the army.
It was very innocent, believe it or not. We didn't do it, hey, let's get high. That was not the reason for it at all. We didn't think we were doing anything wrong because it wasn't a street drug. It was a medication. It was a prescription drug.
The first time I realized that Elvis was taking medication, I was looking down at his nightstand and I saw all these prescription bottles and I said, are you sick? And he said, no, I had a little sore throat, you know, like, and I need that pill for sleep sometimes. And, you know, I was a little taken aback by it, but, you know, I reconciled it in my mind.
Elvis studied about pills and prescriptions. He had physicians' desk reference books, you know, and he thought he was a doctor, for goodness sake. And being who he was, he'd get anything he wanted.
The start of this decline was his mental state about his career.
My mother died, giving me Elvis was becoming increasingly disillusioned with the relentless touring and night after night Vegas routine.
To play Vegas, 2 months a year, 120 something shows. What's the challenge?
The second time I saw him, it was not good. He looked so different, but he had a feeling that it was like a kind of charade he was going through.
How was the sound in that building?
Very good, very good.
Very, very good.
And they were all saying, hey, pretty good tonight. And I just wanted to say, no, it was not good. When I spoke to him backstage, he kind of wasn't there. He was probably on some kind of dope. Elvis was consuming large quantities of pills. You know, it's a very difficult thing to monitor. I would maybe wake up and he's not in bed and I'd have to go and find him and he might be on the floor in the office somewhere or in his bathroom.
Elvis's problems were becoming impossible to hide.
So tired of working for nothing.
I had not seen an Elvis concert in some time, and I was very disappointed in it. What really disappointed me the most was that he couldn't remember the words to My Way, and he had Charlie Hodge bring the words up to him. I thought it was tragic.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain.
I couldn't watch pictures of him. I couldn't pick up a picture of him in the paper. I could not watch, even now, a fat, bloated Elvis.
I've lived, life is full, I traveled east.
How close is the image to the man?
Well, the image is one thing, and a human being is another, you know. It's very hard to live up to an image, I'll put it that way.
Go to the house sometime and talk to him. He said, it's pitiful. He said, I got all this stuff here, but I'd like, just like to go back to three pieces again and play and have fun. He didn't want to be Elvis after a while. He said, I'm getting so tired of being Elvis. That's what he told me.
I did everything from flush medicine down the toilet to cry, to beg, to make him realize that he needed to stop being so self-destructive. And I couldn't reach him. After nearly 5 years, I just had to make that very tough decision to leave with the full knowledge that he probably would not be in this world much longer.
Elvis died at his home on August the 16th, 1977.
Elvis Presley was pronounced dead here at Baptist Hospital. His road manager, Joe Esposito, had found Presley in his bedroom, unconscious.
And I went upstairs to talk to him. He wasn't breathing.
It's not real.
No, it's not. It's our prayer.
The cause of death is cardiac arrhythmia due to undetermined causes.
I never thought Elvis would die on us. Never. We always thought he was so strong. I just couldn't. I couldn't handle it.
I was devastated. I just really cried. I sat there and cried on my own. Elvis was a large part of my life, and that was it. He was dead.
Burning brighter somewhere.
He was such a damn beautiful baby. And I'm not just talking about physically, because I think we all can see that. There's something about him that is just, it absolutely is ingrained in more people's hearts and minds and souls, if you will, than any person that's ever lived on this earth, and unless it may be Jesus Christ.
Why can't my dream come true? Oh, why?
Oh, I miss his smile. I had the greatest, warmest smile in the world.
Understanding.
I miss him tremendously.
Sometimes.
A guy like Elvis, you know, in your mind, or a lot of people's mind, he would never die. Elvis can't die, you know, he's too big, he's too great.
If I can dream of a warmer sun.
Elvis's musical influence still resonates.
Tell me why.
He was an intuitive genius, shot across, you know, our lives.
If Elvis is in hell, then I demand a recount. Because although Elvis clearly was wild, Elvis has brought so much just pure, unadulterated joy into the world. He's got to be in heaven. He's just got to be.